Welcome to Time Turner Thursdays, a special feature of Hogwarts Radio that revisits some of our more popular episodes over the past 10 years. Episode 55 was released on August 3rd, 2010, and celebrates the second anniversary of our show. The panel also welcomes Mary Smith, a brand new host, to the podcast. Join the team as they go deep into the Pensive to discuss what viewers will be seeing from the Ministry of Magic in the new Deathly Hallows film. Is it important Professor Lupin's visit to Grimmauld Place be included? How will Mundungus Fletcher be included? And how will Slytherin's locket be introduced? The hosts answer these burning questions and much more. Plus, the wrong answer game makes its much-anticipated return to the program. We hope you have as much fun re-listening and revisiting some of these older episodes as we had recording them. Thank you for your continued support of our podcast. This is Hogwarts Radio, episode number 55 for August 3rd, 2010, the one with Ariel Seashells. Grayson, you have a problem with the wrong answer game, don't you?
I do have a problem with the wrong answer game, and we said this on the live show, but you lost the.
I'm sorry. Don't blame me. Don't blame me. Anyway, what's your
problem? Okay, the game is called the wrong answer game. The object of the game is to get the wrong answer. Hence, it's a double negative, where if you give the wrong answer to the game, you're not winning the wrong answer game. The only wrong answer to the game is the original correct answer.
Okay, but the purpose of the wrong answer game is to answer the question wrong, not correctly,
yes.
As that would make it an incorrect answer. Hang on. To the wrong answer game. Not the wrong answer, making it the right. It's incorrect, not wrong.
Try to do this on Facebook, too. You can't make a synonym for wrong and say it's different because it's not. It's the same thing. Incorrect and wrong are the same thing. The wrong answer, okay, it's a wrong answer game and you give the wrong answer. Hence, the wrong answer to a wrong answer game is the right answer. But you can't give the wrong answer unless you're giving the right answer.
Okay.
That's the only way to do it.
Okay, well, which is why the wrong answer is the correct answer to the wrong answer.
No, it's not.
The correct answer.
It's a double negative. This is simple grammatical rules. It's double negative.
But
that's how it works.
Okay? Hang on. But you're trying to answer the question wrong to get it right. It would be correct to answer the wrong answer to the wrong answer game. It would be incorrect to answer the right answer to the wrong
answer
game.
You're saying correct and wrong a bunch of times. You're not making any sense.
Yes, I am.
Okay, shut up.
Okay. Anyway.
Okay. Moving on.
Now that we made everybody's head spin, hello. Hello. Welcome back.
Oh, my God. It's a great way to start the show.
I know. It is. welcome back, everybody. This is episode numero 55. Number 55. We are we're chugging right along, I guess. we have tons of stuff to talk about this week, so we're going to get into this show before we confuse everybody even further. So I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm Reverend Grayson Smith.
God, I'm Becca Schroeder.
And I'm Mary Terzian.
Yay!
Oh my God, I'm not last anymore. Sorry, that just hit me. That's kind of exciting, actually.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have an important announcement to make. Very, very important announcement to make. Okay, wow, you guys were actually quiet for that one.
Okay, sorry we're being polite. Sorry,
I know. Okay. We actually have...
We have a brand new host to Hogwarts Radio. Mary Terzian is joining us for her Hogwarts Radio debut. Welcome.
Debuted?
Hi, guys.
Hello.
Here.
Terrence, you ruined her debut. You said, first of all, you said debuted. And
I said
also
debut.
We're just not making any sense the whole time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I said debut.
No. Okay. Well, that's not how you pronounce it, Redneck.
I'm not. Anyway, Mary is joining us after an exhaustive host search. It wasn't that bad.
It was exhaustive. It was a lot of interviews.
But it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. We got to meet a lot of people. We had an absolute blast interviewing everybody. I think that, well, there was a lot of applicants, there we go, to the show, and that were very interested. I felt bad that I couldn't, that we couldn't choose everybody, because everybody had really strong qualifications for being hosts on the show. But I'm very pleased with the choice that we made and having Mary join our team.
Thank you.
I think you're going to make a great addition. Well, before we get into the rest of the show, do you want to tell everybody how you got into Harry Potter? It's kind of a tradition we do with our hosts. But just tell how you got into Harry Potter, how you, I guess, been involved with the fandom, if you have, or, you know, things like that.
All right. Well, I started reading the first Harry Potter book when I think I was about 11. And my mom saw something on the news about it and was like, you should start reading these books. And I was like, well, I already am. And I read the first four, I believe. And then the movie came out. It was such a big deal to me. And I thought it was so scandalous that I liked Daniel Radcliffe because he was 2 years younger than me. And he was 11. And then I went to all the midnight release parties. I recently went to Wizarding World of Harry Potter, and I spent way more than I'd like to say on merchandise. And I listened to the podcast. I've been listening for a while now, and I just love it because I don't really have too many friends who are Harry Potter fans. So it's really nice to listen to people talking about it. And now I get to join in, which is awesome. So thank you.
Woo-hoo. Great. No, we're absolutely thrilled to have you. And
is Becca again?
Yeah, Becca's DJ Schroeder in the house.
What did I do this
time? All I did was unmute myself. That's it. I swear.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, DJ Schroeder is going to let us get through the rest of the show here.
I'm done. Thank you guys.
Thank you so much for applying, because I think you're going to make a great addition to the show, Mary.
Thank you. And I've gotten some really nice tweets so far, really welcoming. So thank you, you guys.
You've gotten a lot of followers, haven't you? Well, not a lot, but like, I don't know. I think, weren't you at like, not in Twitter stalking here, like 72 last night, and then it was announced, and then you jumped somewhere up to like 90 or something?
Yeah, exactly.
Nice. You're welcome.
Oh, thank you. You raised specifically.
I did it. Yep. The Reverend provided all the followers for you. No problem. That's what I do. I help people. Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, all right. Well, again, welcome to the family, and we give you a big old group hug if we weren't like thousands of miles apart. So
that's nice.
Let's actually get into the show this week. There is a show, believe it or not.
Wait, we do that? We talk about Harry Potter?
We do. We do. In fact, let's talk about some Harry Potter news. Most recently, okay. Emma Thompson, who plays Sybil Trelawney in the Harry Potter films, is scheduled to receive a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame on Friday, August 6th. Now, Miss Thompson, who has won the two Best Actress Academy Awards for her work in Howard's End and Sense and Sensibility, will be joined by Maggie Gyllenhaal and Hugh Lowry in speaking at the late morning ceremony in front of the Pig and Whistle Pub, on Hollywood Boulevard in Los Angeles. So, I mean... I've seen some of her other work, most recently, what was it, The Nanny McPhee Diaries?
Nanny McPhee Diaries, what?
Oh, wait,
no.
Hang on.
It's,
was
no.
it just called Nanny McPhee?
There we go, okay.
Yeah. He's trying to combine different movies.
Sorry.
I don't know what he's doing. Yes, NPC.
Do we ever know what he's doing?
No. Do you still have Grimmauld Walk of Fame? I went there like a couple months ago. That thing is long. There's lots of stars on there.
Well, yeah.
I couldn't even see all of them. There's so many. It just goes on for miles and miles. That's ridiculous.
So what do you guys think?
I can't really go to that part of town. I live really close to Hollywood, but I mean, it's really dirty.
I love Hollywood's so cool. I don't care. Hollywood's awesome. I love Hollywood. So no one else does, but I do.
I mean, it's really nice on Sunset. There are a bunch of all of the places, the venues and stuff, but yeah, I mean,
does that still exist, or is that like forever ago? No, okay.
But
you think I am?
No, I'm still. I that's where my group started. So I'm trying to figure out if that place still exists, and I have no idea.
No, they all still exist.
Oh, it does. Okay, well.
Yeah, everything's still there.
Very good.
Nice.
Yep.
The next news story here, the lead actor of the Harry Potter film series, his name is Daniel Radcliffe, I think, spoke with the Los Angeles Times a few days ago via phone and commented on the rumors about his presence at the past week's Comic-Con convention in San Diego. And he said, "I apologize to all the wishful thinkers for my disappointing non-presence," because apparently there were rumors that he was going to appear. I mean, it was really, really on the down low. It wasn't confirmed until nobody saw him there, really. The article goes on to say the actor, who has finished some post-production voice work for the last Potter film, says he's still grappling a bit with the concept that he will never wear the robes of Hogwarts on screen again. He still cares deeply about Potter fans, though. He sounded genuinely distressed to hear for the first time about the wildfire rumors that led fans to believe that he would be at the San Diego Pop Culture Expo that wrapped up on Sunday. And to that he said, "Really? Oh God, I had no idea. I suppose it's like when I'm at Reading Festival and I hear that suddenly some amazing band is going to play a surprise gig and then it turns out to be total fiction." And then he goes on to talk about how his 21st birthday went, which judging from the pictures, I don't know if anybody had seen that. It looks like he had a really awesome time. Looks like he got totally, what is it that the British use? The word
smashed.
No, that's
Backers.
What we use.
No.
it's I think it's pissed. He got totally pissed.
Yeah. I guess smashed.
Yeah. but better. What I
knackered is when you're tired. I forgot.
You know, it just hit me now. We'll never see Daniel Radcliffe on film in Hogwarts robes again. Oh, my God.
Did it hit you because you read that in the news story?
It did. It did. I mean, I read it whenever I put it in, and I was like, oh, okay, uh-huh. And then now it's like it's kind of hit me. I'm kind of sad.
Technically, we still have a year left in two movies before that happens, so.
Yeah, but knowing that he's done, I mean, it's. It is sad.
It's going to hit all of us as soon as we're done watching part two, and we're just going to be complete messes.
Oh, God.
I don't even want to think about it.
I'm trying not to.
I probably won't care. So.
Okay.
You're Grayson. A horrible person.
Yes, I'm horrible because a work of fiction does not make me a mess in a theater.
Okay. Shut up.
I'm just kidding.
any thoughts on the rest of the article? I mean.
Sweet. It was well read.
Thanks, Grayson.
I think
I put Jim Dale to rest, don't I?
To rest.
I think when you're quotes, you should use an accent.
No, please don't encourage him.
No.
Yes,
you really shouldn't.
Really? Oh God, I had no idea.
He would be done. Oh goodness.
I suppose when it. I could use like a California surfer kind of accent.
No.
I suppose.
Grayson, this is where you kick him off the call.
Anyway.
Oh, I could do that.
No, Grayson, you don't want to do that. Anyway, let's move on to the next news story here. A new promotional image from Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part 1 was released in France's Gallimard publication? I don't know what that says. Gallimard.
It's exquisite, sir.
Something fantastic. Like that. Featuring Harry climbing up the steps of Grimmauld Place, wand in hand. And the image can be seen in high resolution at snitchseeker.com. and you could check it out. It's one of their most recent news postings. But have you guys had to take a look at it? Any thoughts?
Yeah, the picture looks really great. I mean, you know, you got Harry there with the French all around him. And
is that what
wand
is that
right there lit up? Lumos and stuff.
What they said it's in Grimmauld Place, but what? Honestly, I don't. How did they come to that conclusion? What gives that away in there?
It doesn't. That almost looks like Pensive next to him. What is that?
Well, if you look at the wallpaper, it's kind of Grimmauld Placey, like this, you know.
I agree with you, Mary. It kind of looks like a stone Pensive right there.
But the problem with it being that, though, is that it's actually in the wall, and like a part of it, you know? Like, it's got the wall, and it goes in, and that's where that thing is, and then it's got the rest of the wall.
Ooh, I like his sweater in the high-resolution image. It looks really, really comfy.
Oh, I just love his sweater. Ooh.
Shut up.
I should have one of those to take home with me.
I know. Sorry.
You see that accent, Terrence.
Thanks, Grayson. But, no, I am interested to see how they came up with Grimmauld Place out of that particular shot right there.
I think it's a wallpaper.
Oh, well, now that I look at the trailer, he's wearing his sweater is different than the one that he's wearing in the trailer when he confronts Voldemort, so it probably isn't when he's going to the Pensive.
Yeah, that's true. Because
they're not on the same day.
Yeah, exactly. It's just right within, you know, hours of each other.
Okay. Unless he goes to the Pensive and then he's like, ooh, it's going to be cold outside when I go to die, so let me put on a jacket.
that'd be good.
Yeah, there you go.
That makes sense. That would explain
That's the change that they're adding. That's the huge change. Harry's going to put on a jacket.
Terrence, I can't believe you said that. Oh, I love his sweater. Ooh.
Sorry.
So nice.
It looked
kind of
nice.
I don't know what kind of fabric that is.
Does it really surprise you at all? I mean,
it really looked comfy, is what I'm saying. Anyway, okay. I believe the next to the last news story is not even 2 months after the Wizarding World of Harry Potter theme park opened in Orlando. There are rumors now concerning a park to be opened in India featuring rides from Universal properties such as Harry Potter. And they're, of course, they're trying to build like an Islands of Adventure there or something. There's going to be Jaws, E.T., Spider-Man, different things like that, as confirmed in an interview from the Wall Street Journal. So what do you guys think? I mean, India, next place for a Harry Potter park? I don't know.
I mean, I think it would be great to have something on the other side of the world because there are so many fans.
Yeah, I mean, it could be anywhere. Why not there?
Chris, I wasn't here. What are you saying, though? India? Slumdog Millionaire? Good film. Fantastic.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I mean, I would expect the next great place would be, like, Britain, or maybe even one in Los Angeles. Why not?
Terrence, we discussed this before. You can't put one in London. There's not enough room.
Yeah, there is.
It's an island. There's not enough room.
There's plenty of room in London.
No, there's not.
Okay, what about Los Angeles?
India, really?
What about Los Angeles?
Isn't India kind of like a ridiculously impoverished country?
No, actually, India is really... I know, Grayson, you're going to offend all of our India listeners.
No, I'm saying, like, isn't most, like, a lot of it impoverished? That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
No.
I watched Slumdog Millionaire. That's the impression I got.
There's well over a billion people in India. It's not.
I know that, but it's just because there's a billion people here doesn't mean that we're not impoverished, because we are in a lot of places. That's all I'm saying.
In a lot of places, but not everywhere.
Well, let me ask you a question. Yeah. Why not?
Forget it.
Why not? No, why not India?
It's built next to the Taj Mahal. That'd be cool.
That'd be awesome.
Hogwarts right next to the Taj Mahal. Yeah.
Sacred landmark. We'll build a theme park full of gluttony and you know, turkey legs.
Okay.
In there.
Okay. Answer my question here. What about Los Angeles? Why not?
There's already too much stuff there. So I would love it if there was one here because I live here. But, I mean, we already have one in the U.S. It would be kind of selfish if we built another one in the U.S.
Because the U.S. already isn't selfish.
Well, okay, no. Okay, well, why have two Disney parks then?
Because Disney rules.
Okay, doesn't Universal rule?
What did you say?
I said, those are all over the place, though. I mean, there's really only one Harry Potter theme park now, and it's on this side of the world, so why don't we put one on the exact opposite side? I mean, kind of, almost.
Well, that's true.
You can't put it in England, Terrence. It's an island, no room.
Okay.
I'm telling you, they don't have any room left. All they have left is farming land, and they can't fit it there. I'm telling you.
Well, if you're getting specific like that, everything is technically an island. So.
That really is. Okay, it's. Forget it. Never mind. Whatever.
I win.
No, you don't. I'm still like arguing.
According to the article, the park would look much like Universal's other major theme parks in LA, Orlando, Japan. With a variety of roller coasters, rides, shops, movie-related merchandise, and nearby hotels. The complex is expected to stretch over 400 acres, which would make it one of the biggest such sites in the world, said a person close to the matter. So, 400 acres, that's huge. That's bigger than, I think that's bigger than Islands of Adventure is right now. But yeah,
apparently India is not an impoverished country.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Slumdog Millionaire just screwed me over there. It made it look like it's just giant trash heaps.
Well, I hear Abu Dhabi is banging. But really, in the city too. That's all I know.
That's the word on the street. Then, all right. Wait, did you hear that from Sex in the City too?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Grayson, you saw Sex in the City too?
No, I just know that's the premise of the movies that they go to Abu Dhabi.
Oh,
even
okay.
I actually filmed it in Morocco. FYI.
Oh, okay.
Really? Oh, that sucks. Yeah.
So Morocco was banging.
What about?
What's really hot in Sex in the City is the girl that plays Charlotte. I don't know what her name is, but I know her character name. She's hot. Anyways. Sorry.
Anyway, wrapping up the story here, Reliance's big entertainment subsidiary, the company that's actually supposed to build the park, and Universal, a unit of General Electric companies, NBC Universal, are still discussing terms but could reach a deal this year. One person familiar with the matter warned, however, that talks are at an early stage and could yet break down. So, you know, it's still a work in progress, we could say that. Nothing's been finalized yet. It's just, you know, it's speculation, it's talk. The final news story today, the black shirt. There's the first Deathly Hallows shirt, t-shirt has appeared at Hot Topic. Well, you can check it out at hottopic.com. It's, the shirt itself is black and has an undesirable number one poster on it with Harry's face and name. And it actually moves and things like that. I'm just kidding. God, but I'm
really?
a similar shirt appeared at Comic-Con and was given out to those who attended the Warner Brothers panel. So you guys can go and check that out at hottopic.com and search up Harry Potter. This is around the time of, I guess, of year before the Harry Potter films come out, where they start to promote a lot of merchandise for the following movie. And usually they have pretty good stuff. I know that I spent a ridiculous amount of money 1 year at Hot Topic buying a whole bunch of Harry Potter stuff.
Hot pink shirts and some gauged earrings and
thanks.
And spray paint for your hair.
Yes.
You can actually find some pretty good stuff at Hot Topic.
Yeah, how about a Gryffindor shirt at Hot Topic?
Well, see, and Hot Topic, this is what I love about Hot Topic, because things, you know, trends come and go all the time. And Harry Potter is one of those trends. Harry Potter and Twilight, but though I don't care about Twilight. Harry Potter and Twilight are, you know, both come and go as their own separate trends. So in the clearance rack, about like a month or two after the movie comes out, you can find like awesome Harry Potter shirts there for like $3.99. It's awesome.
That's where I got my Gryffindor shirt.
Yeah.
Clearance rack.
Exactly. That's where I got
this there.
Yeah. So that's it for the news. I'm not going to ask if anybody has anything else because that's pretty much it. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go ahead and go to commercial. We'll be back in just a couple of moments. The featured band, we want to let you guys know before you listen to them. The featured band for this show is Wingardium Leviosa, you haven't had any opportunity to check him out, go to myspace.com, search up Wingardium Leviosa, or go to the Wizrocklopedia. I think that's how you say it. Wizrocklopedia.
I can say it.
The Wizrocklopedia.
There you go. Yeah, go there. Search up Wingardium Leviosa. Listen to them. They were at Azkatraz whenever we were there. So we might have seen them. We might not have. I think I might have. But I was listening to some of their stuff the other day. Really, really good stuff. So we want to go ahead and feature them on this episode of Hogwarts Radio. So stay tuned, you guys. Don't go anywhere. We got some announcements and some discussion, I think, coming up, I think. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Maybe. Yes.
Depends on how I'm feeling. I don't know.
Depends on how
we discuss things related to Harry Potter. What's that about?
Anyway.
Plan too.
Wow. Stay tuned. Oh. Don't touch your iPod. Don't press that pause button. We'll be right back. Too late, right? We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors.
Today's episode is also brought to you in part by the Noble Collection. Ever wonder if you could get your hands on the Goblet of Fire? How about Luna's fabulous earrings? That's right, you can even purchase your very own Firebolt. Hurry to thenoblecollection.com to get the very best deals on amazing prop replicas from the movies. Separate yourself from the rest of the muggles with an official wand. If you can't get to Diagon Alley, don't worry, the Noble Collection has it all. Be sure you check them out at www.thenoblecollection.com.
Okay, you guys, let's get to this week's announcements here. Hogwarts Radio, well, maybe I should preface it with announcement number one, or first announcement. Hogwarts Radio turns 2 years old, you guys.
Woo!
2 years old. Can you believe it?
Yes.
No.
No, honestly, I can't. I can't believe it. I can't believe that we've been around for 2 years already. Grayson, do you remember the first time we all sat down to record?
I do remember. I remember we recorded a whole episode and then my internet crashed. Oh, it's like a parallel to tonight. Oh, man.
Oh, gosh.
Yes, it is.
But we lost the whole recording that time.
Well, we've learned a thing or two since then. But on Twitter...
We have.
It's so weird. It's like... I've made good memories on the show.
On Twitter, we asked you to send your birthday love out to us via a tweet. So we're going to go ahead and read a couple of those tweets right now. Because I said that I would. The first tweet comes from Reverend Grayson OG.
Wow.
Actually, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Wow. The first tweet comes from Medivier. Medivier? M-E-D-V-I-E-R. Says, happy birthday, Hogwarts Radio. And they retweeted us. AI Nante says, happy birthday, Hogwarts Radio. They retweeted us.
You can't read retweets. Okay.
I won't read retweets.
Taylor E. Farrell says, happy birthday, you guys. Your podcast is brilliant. And welcome, Mary. Smiley face.
Mandy. XX.
That's not just a retweet.
XX Mandy X16. I am totally in love with Hogwarts Radio. Room of Radcliffe. Happy birthday, Hogwarts Radio. Scott Cocktail. Happy birthday. Ruam Potter. Can I hear the radio through the internet? How can I do? Yes, you can hear the radio through the internet. Just go to our site and click up that Listen Now button, our album art. You'll be able to hear us. KB8YKA says, happy second birthday. My, how you've grown. Here's a little bit of love for the big day. XXOO. Joe Rolling Net says, wish at Hogwarts Radio a happy second birthday. Hashtag Pottermania.
M. Watson says, Grayson, will you marry me? And I say yes.
Sure.
I will.
Voldy the Moldy. Voldy the Moldy says, happy birthday. May your toddling years be ever so great. Weasley Chick 93. She writes, so I really wanted to try out to be the new host of Hogwarts Radio, but I ran out of time. Still, though, congrats to the new host. I'm sure you'll do brilliant. And also, happy second birthday to Hogwarts Radio. Host of podcast says...
That's all everyone said.
No, that isn't. Host of podcast said, aw, Hogwarts Radio is all grown up. Happy second birthday.
You can't read your own tweet. It doesn't work that way.
Becca _ Schroeder says, happy second birthday to Hogwarts Radio. Can't believe it's been 2 years already. Crazy stuff. Okay. So thank you so much for all the birthday wishes, you guys. That's just a few of them. We didn't go through all of them yet. But thank you so much for all the birthday wishes. Here's to another 2 years, guys. I can't wait. Next announcement here. Subscribe to us on iTunes and leave us a review, please. Since no one can vote for us on Podcast Alley. Just kidding. We're asking you all to vote. I'm sorry, to leave us a small comment on the iTunes and let everyone know what you think of the show. Be honest and give us feedback about it. That's what that's there for.
Constructive criticism.
Exactly. We love it. The third announcement here, our transcript team is starting back up. Shannon is in the process of revamping the team due to a few people that have emailed in expressing interest. Now, if you are interested in becoming a part of the transcript team, then email us at staff@hogwartsradio.com or shannon@hogwartsradio.com, and she'll let you know what you need to do from there. So I think that's it for this week's announcements. We're going to go ahead and we normally go to commercial break right now, but we already went to one. So we're going to get right into our main discussion, which is Into the Pensive, chapters 11 and 12. Discussion of Deathly Hallows. Now, this, for the new people out there that are listening, this isn't necessarily discussing the chapters themselves. It's discussing what we would like to see in the movie, cinematography-wise, what what's realistic, what we can actually expect to see. So this week, Chapter 11 starts out on the U.S. hardcover edition, pages 201 to 222, and on the U.K. hardcover edition, pages 166 to 183. The chapter summary provided by the Harry Potter Lexicon is in which Lupin seeks out Harry, Ron, and Hermione at Grimmauld Place and offers to accompany them on their quest, but Harry refuses, recognizing that Lupin is seeking escape from complications in his personal life. Creature returns with Mundungus, who reveals that Umbridge took the locket from him as a bribe for not turning him in for selling magical artifacts without a license. So, you guys, as I say all the time, what can we expect? What's realistic? Okay. And what are we actually going to see?
I need to say something first, okay? How are they going to introduce Mundungus or introduce this entire storyline with the locket at all? Seeing as how we haven't seen the real locket, you know, it wasn't in Grimmauld Place, but the moviegoers don't know that. And we've never seen Mundungus or mention of Mundungus ever before.
That's a good question, Grace. And do you have any theories or how could they do that? I mean, you're the film guy. How would they explain that?
I don't know. You can't just introduce an entirely new character into this because it's a random part of the movie. So
maybe they'll all just be sitting around talking about it and Creature will be listening in and say, oh, hey, that locket that, you know, my master had in this one time.
Master. Yeah. Master but took Creature's locket.
Shut up. Sorry, okay. Sorry. How do you explain how Umbridge gets it, though? That's the problem. I don't know. That's the thing.
Maybe
when Mundungus comes back, then he'll just say, yeah, well, I stole it, and then, you know, she took it from me. Maybe they'll do like a flashback. I hope they don't do
okay, that. Okay, so you're saying that Creature will tell them that Mundungus took it, and that's how they're going to introduce that? Is that what you mean?
They
yeah,
could say
I
that.
Think so.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, that's how they – it's a nice, cheap way to introduce it, really, yeah. Because they've honestly – they I don't want to say they've screwed themselves with it, but they're – it'll be, I guess it'll flow really well to the moviegoer, to the person that just watches the Harry Potter
movie. It's going to be like, Creature be like, oh, I know, it's this guy Mundungus. And all of a sudden it's going to be like, they're supposed to know who he is. And all of a sudden it's his new character in the movie.
Now,
well, Mundungus is early. He's in the Seven Potters scene.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
I wonder if they're going to put him in there, though.
Is Mundungus in this movie, Terrence? Do we know that?
You know what?
Yeah, he's cast.
Okay. Then, yeah, all I have to do, actually, that's a good point. All I have to do is introduce him to the Seven Potter scene as, like, a new Order of the Phoenix guy. And then somehow explain that he took the locket, which I don't know.
I guess.
You know what they could do? They could do what they're supposed to do in Half-Blood Prince, where they see Harry sees Mundungus with Sirius' stuff. Like, they could show, like, a flash of him taking something, you know? Like something, like, in his pocket he puts away and Harry eyes him, that kind of thing. So you know that he's stealing things, but he's still a new character, you know?
That's true. And Mary, you put in the show notes here that Mundungus' story could possibly be a flashback. Did you have any thoughts on that?
I hope it isn't, though, because we're already going to get, like, the flashes to Harry seeing through Voldemort, and then probably Creature's tale is probably going to be a flashback because it would be boring just looking at him on the screen telling the story. But I don't know. I was just wondering how it would show that it was Umbridge who took it, because in the book he says, oh, a woman who looked like a toad. And we know that from the book, that Umbridge is described that way. But in the movie, she doesn't really look like a toad.
Yeah.
So
oh, yeah,
I was thinking maybe they would just say she was wearing a lot of pink. And then they would be like, oh.
Exactly. That's a woman in pink came by too. Or something. Yeah.
Smelled like cats, she did.
Yeah.
Took Creature's locket.
I don't know. Anyway, so let's talk a little bit about Lupin's visit. We've seen Lupin in the movies as kind of this kind of the cool guy, you know, kind of the the professor that was there, and you know, he helped Harry get by. And then we saw him in Order of the Phoenix. And he kind of I don't know. He was there. You could tell he still had that cool aura about him. But you know, whenever we see him in Deathly Hallows, he's supposed to be like a completely, you know, like a completely different person, it seems like.
Well, they kind of show in Half-Blood Prince, the movie, they kind of show him being, you know, kind of branching out. He gets upset at Harry when Harry's accusing Snape again. He says, he's like yelling, not yelling, but he's raising his voice, talking about it comes down to whether or not you trust Dumbledore, as far as if you can trust Snape. So I think they're kind of showing that. But
would this be one of the scenes that's necessary to...
It's not necessary, but it'd be really nice to see, because it kind of shows that how people are reacting to everything that's going on, and how someone that we've seen as calm, cool, and a generally nice guy just gets so upset, and so he just throws away his responsibilities, essentially.
Oh yeah, yeah, and he, I remember reading this before before the show, and Joe described it was. He grabbed handfuls of his own hair, and you know,
looks
whenever deranged. He's going, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's a new side of Lupin that the moviegoers haven't seen.
I think it'd be cool to show, like I said, to show what this whole situation is doing to everybody.
Now
it's changing people.
Could David Thewlis pull it off?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Really?
I think this whole scene is really great because it again shows Harry's struggle about not having parents, and I think that is really one of the central points of the entire book, so it's got to be a central point in the movie. It's a lot about family, Dumbledore's family, and then especially with this, if they show Lupin's argument, it's just a reminder of how much Harry values family and parents. And, you know, there's this really nice paragraph in the book where it says that broken images were racing through his mind, Sirius falling through the veil, Dumbledore when he died, and then his dad, the flash of green light. So yeah. I think it would be really nice if they include this scene. It would be a reflection of Harry's character, the way that he responds to it.
Oh, that would, yeah, that's good, great that you brought that up, because I do remember reading that, and I'm like, wow, you know, I could actually see them doing these bits of flashes at this part of the book. And I think it is a good refresher of Harry's character and in what he's going through in his mind and things like that. And the reason why he kind of flew off the handle like he did towards Lupin. Now, is this the first time in in the series that they start to refer to people by their first names? You know, they kind of break out of that Professor Lupin, and now they're just calling him Remus.
Yeah, I know. It shows their maturity a lot. I think it's the first time. I don't remember. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, no.
I think it's the first time. Yeah, I think you're right.
It's really nice because it's like, hey, you're my equal now. You're not just my professor. I can tell you if you can come with me on this trip or not.
Okay. Another thing that upsets me about this is all the Daily Prophet things. You know, because how are like in the beginning of the book, you got Elpheus Doge and he's talking about Dumbledore, and then Rita Skeeter's talking about Dumbledore, and it's all that's all supposed to explain everything about Dumbledore. It's how we know in the book the backstory of that. How do they take that in the movie and make it into a scene?
Yeah, no, exactly. In fact, Mary, you had a great point about this. The extract from Dumbledore's biography in the Daily Prophet, you're saying that the Dumbledore storyline must stay. Is that right?
Yes. I actually talked about this in my interview. You want me to say it again?
Yeah, go for it if you want to.
Yeah, really, let me see if I can say this as eloquently as I did before, but really, I feel like the Dumbledore storyline we talked, you guys talked about it in a previous episode, that it would be better to just leave it out, because then Dumbledore's character could stay pure. We wouldn't have to ruin it for the movie fans.
That was all Grayson. I never said to leave it. I'm so passionate about leaving the storyline in, but I'm sorry to interrupt you. Go ahead.
Okay.
Yes, no. I am passionate about it too, because I believe that it is absolutely necessary for two reasons. My reasons are twofold. First one being that all of J.K. Rowling's characters are flawed, as you guys talked about in the last episode. All of them are flawed, so I think that it would be an injustice to Dumbledore's character to not show his flaws. So that is the first point, and I think that it is absolutely crucial to be left in. Second point, the books and the movies are mostly through Harry's point of view, and I don't think that showing Dumbledore's flaws, showing his past, would ruin his image for the fans, even the movie fans, because as we were reading the book, we were upset about Dumbledore's flaws, but then we came to terms with it, as Harry did, and I think that that would apply for the movie fans as well.
See, okay, I gotta defend myself here. Okay, I think they should leave it in. I really want them to, because I like in movies when characters progress and you learn things and you know lessons are taught. But my point was that for WB, it's about selling the tickets. You don't have to like teach anyone anything. They can totally get away with just keeping everything as it is, and you just Dumbledore as like kind of a Gandalf-ish figure, and just have him in the background, and you know, coming like at the Resurrection Stone at the end. I mean, at the forest in the end when Harry dies and everything. So I think you should leave it in, but I'm just saying they don't have to. Like they could feasibly get away with it, you know.
Yeah, but it would just be such a tragedy if they cut it off.
Yeah, it would
and
be.
Probably no. I mean, if they're including little details about Mundungus, not details, but about what happened with Mundungus, and then we know in the Ministry of Magic the whole storyline of the Cattermoles, because we know that they cast both of the Cattermoles, and they're probably going to leave in the huge Dumbledore storyline.
Yeah.
And they
I really want them to leave it in, but like if you think about it, if they just didn't do anything about Dumbledore, they just kept him as he is, half the audience would be none the wiser, you know. Half of all the book fans would be pissed off, but the rest of the people that are just there to see the movies and have seen just the movies wouldn't really care.
I'm kind of thinking they have to keep it in because it is a major part of the books.
How though?
Because
not really.
No, actually, it is.
It's a major part of Dumbledore's character, but it's and Harry learning things, but it's not a major part of the plot. As if you boil the plot down to its essence, it has nothing to do with it.
Actually, it has a lot to do with it. How? You learn we learn that Harry is. That Dumbledore was tempted by, you know, by the Hallows.
Why do you know that? Why do you know that in the movie?
Because it's all about the choices, Harry.
Exactly.
But Harry can learn that on his own. Or he can see like some kind of a vision of Dumbledore and he can say that. I mean, you don't have to have it.
But how much of a meaning to the moviegoer would that mean to Harry if he were to just, you know, not have the guidance and the mistakes of Dumbledore to learn from? I mean, Dumbledore...
They're not going to be any the wiser. They won't know the difference.
Dumbledore chose the Hallows over the Horcruxes, okay? He thought that if he could, you know, make himself happy, bring him back his, you know, his lost loved ones, and Harry has the same kind of temptation, but he understands what needs to be done. He doesn't get sidetracked. Yeah, he thinks about it for a little bit, but he doesn't get sidetracked about the whole, you know, Hallows and Horcruxes thing. He goes after what he needs to and what's important, and he says, Dumbledore wanted me to go after the Horcruxes. And I think it's important because the Deathly Hallows represent temptation that Harry can, you know, that ties himself, he tries to tie himself into it, but in the end, he ends up, it's about the choice that he makes, Hallows over Horcruxes over Hallows.
But he can learn that on his own. He doesn't need Dumbledore to do it. In a movie where you boil the plot down to its essence, it's about finding Horcruxes, and then it's about you find Hallows. Do you choose between those or that? Harry can learn to choose the Horcruxes on his own. He doesn't have to have Dumbledore to do it. He doesn't have to have people's mistakes to do it. He can just do it. Choose that.
I don't think so.
It's not. I'm saying it should be in it because it's great and it reveals a lot about the character and a lot about Harry. Well, not a lot about Harry, but it reveals something about Harry. But it's not essential. It doesn't have to do it. Just to get by the basic movie, it doesn't have to do. You don't have to do that at all. That's all I'm saying.
But I mean, then why don't we just cut all the movies just down to like half an hour of just the point, or we could just summarize really fast.
I pretty
you
much
know?
Do that anyways. I just say no, but like you think all the things that they cut out lots of things in the movies, lots of things that we think were relevant or were important. I'm just saying, like this is one thing that they could do that. Wouldn't impact a lot of people. I mean, I'd be upset, and a lot of people would be, but...
I mean, I think most of the fans would be really upset about it if they cut it out. I don't think J.K. Rowling would have let them get away with cutting it out.
Yeah.
I don't think that they are going to cut it out. It is an important part of...
I just don't know how they're going to do it.
The Deathly Hallows story. Why don't you think? I mean, Grayson, are you thinking they don't have enough time, or
no? It's not that. It's just that I don't think it's essential. I think it's like if they're trying to include all this different stuff and they want to just, you know, keep it an action packed kind of thing, they don't need this in it. This is like this kind of a story arc is something that like a drama or like some kind of independent movie would have, like about it's a character study. It's not about a journey.
But that's always what made Harry Potter great, was all these story arcs mixed in, you know, to one.
But not the movies. Think about the movies. Think about Sorcerer's Stone and Chamber of Secrets. Those are just about the journey. It's not about anything else, really. It's just about Harry finds out, you know, about his parents. At the end, he gets to Sorcerer's Stone. That's how it goes.
But it's like about finding friendship. It's about finding love and learning that love is more powerful than any kind of magic out there.
But that's because the love thing is important because that's how Harry was saved. The Dumbledore thing is not important because that has nothing to do with Harry. It just has something to do with how he sees Dumbledore and how he perceives things.
So wait, you're telling me that Dumbledore didn't care that it
No, I'm saying that this element of Dumbledore, the flawed element, has nothing to do with Harry. In a movie sense, it has nothing to do with Harry.
Okay, well, there's only a little bit to talk about with Harry. You know, there's not that much. Dumbledore kind of broadens that story. Dumbledore's story kind of, you know, there's a bunch of parallels between Harry's story and Dumbledore's story. I think that it is important to keep it in.
But do you realize that for someone who's looking for the kind of movie that Harry Potter is, seeing parallels to a story told in probably like flashback form or through reading something or hearing something is not going to be that relevant to them. It's not going to be that important. It's going to be something that they think is the best part of the movie. You know? You know what I'm saying?
Mary, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, go for it.
I forgot.
Grayson, really, it's all your fault.
No, it's fine. But it really does affect, I think it really does affect Harry's journey, because then he goes, whoa, Dumbledore wasn't that pure person in what I thought, because Dumbledore is one of his father figures. And I think that really affected him, and it made his journey harder. And a lot of the part about his journey was that he was frustrated with Dumbledore for not being so vague, or leaving him hints instead of just telling him outright what he needed to do. And then this whole storyline added to his frustration and skepticism of Dumbledore. So
I hope they show it and everything, but I don't know how they're gonna do it. I can't.
Well, they have Aunt Muriel. I don't think they're gonna. I really hope that they don't like just flash a Daily Prophet on the
screen,
or that they don't just read it right on it. I think that they'll probably just have Aunt Muriel and Alpheus Doge just arguing at the table about Dumbledore, and then Harry's just sitting there going, what? And I could totally see it. Like, Aunt Muriel pulls out a book. Oh, did you know Rita Skeeter's new book? And she already has it. And stuff. I could see that happening. Yeah. Even though chronologically the book isn't out yet, but I could totally see that happening.
Now, David Gates is infamous for those montages where, you know, flashes with the newspapers. Yeah.
Oh, I hated that in the fifth movie.
But I think knowing that they have two movies to get through and enough time, I think that they might keep that down to a minimum. But I mean, yeah, it's still going
to
be there.
They didn't really do it in Half-Blood Prince, to be fair.
Well, they do. They, well,
yeah,
there
they don't
that
do it
much.
In Half-Blood Prince. Yeah. Half-Blood Prince, I really was pleased with Half-Blood Prince.
Me too.
So that wraps up this chapter. Let's go ahead and get to chapter
two. We weren't.
Oh yeah, my god, we're still on one chapter.
Yeah. Wait, we were finished? Okay.
Let's go ahead and get to chapter number 12. Mary, do you want to go ahead and take the chapter 12?
Yes. Okay, chapter 12, Magic is Might. In this chapter, Harry, Ron, and Hermione, after weeks of planning, ambush three ministry workers, assume their identities, and sneak into ministry headquarters. To their horror, they learn that Ron has taken the identity of a man whose wife is about to be interrogated about her blood status and who faces a sentence in Azkaban for being a muggle born with a wand.
Dun, dun, yeah. Dun.
Scandalous.
Legal.
Okay. There's a lot that goes on here.
Was that the whole synopsis? Was that it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. That was very well read. Very good. I like the inflection in it. And like Terrence, who's monotonous. And
thank you, Grayson.
I feel like I was in the story again, you know?
Yeah. You're awesome. Okay. So there is a lot that goes on in this chapter. There's so much that goes on in this chapter. We can actually expect to see a lot of it from the pictures that we've seen so far. From the trailer that we've seen, we see Ron being all wet, trying to stop the raining in whatever office he was supposed to go into. But the thing that bothered me with that is that's Ron. That's not Cattermole.
What?
Do you think it's like as they're walking out, they're already transforming back? Do you think that's what they're going to do?
Possibly. That's a really good point. I don't know though. Maybe I don't know. Remember in the trailer that we saw Ron and he was like kind of really horror struck and all wet. Do you remember that?
No. I was going to say, maybe it's like, Terrence, you see Inception? Any of you guys see Inception?
Yeah. Well, I kind of slept through Inception, but.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Okay.
No pun intended. No pun intended.
Okay, you know how that one guy, Eves, or whatever his name is, he can transform into people, you know? And when he transforms, you see from the front of his face, he's the one guy that he's transformed into. And then you swing around to the back of him, and he's himself.
Uh-huh.
He switches back like it's a mirror. You know, maybe they're going to do that. That'd be cool. There's
but
that stupid.
Ron's looking in a mirror at that moment.
What's up?
But Ron isn't looking in a mirror.
Yeah, like even if you watch the very end, I watched this like 2 days ago, so I remember. If you watch the very end of the movie, they're sitting on the beach. He's sitting on the beach with the son of the... you know, air of whatever. Yeah. He's sitting there and then the camera swings around like this and they're just sitting there and then his face is back to normal. So it changes when he swings the camera around. Yeah.
I hope they keep it consistent.
Yeah. Oh, I was just kidding. I wouldn't really do that, but you know. No. I'm trying to be hip and like reference Inception.
Okay. 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 We won't talk about the Ron thing anymore because there's so much more stuff to talk about in this chapter. Harry kind of makes this split decision. We should move on the ministry, you know, now. They've been planning for
how I want it now.
They kind of been planning this for weeks, but I mean, Harry kind of makes the decision like we're doing it like now, like tomorrow morning. And Ron and Hermione are like, oh my God, really? And,
Just got real.
It starts out. I think we'll see the beginning part where they have to hide in the alleyway and you know kind of catch the people off guard there. The really big debate right now is about the polyjuice potion and will they keep their original voices or will it be that specific person?
I really hope it's not going to be like Daniel Radcliffe doing some like, because it's still like the Gugu's like 6 feet tall. And I don't really want to see that.
Yeah.
Like Daniel Radcliffe's voice coming out of a huge dude.
Yeah. No.
What did they do when they did, oh crap. Why am I forgetting which book this is in?
Chamber of Secrets?
The first time they did the Polyjuice potion.
Their voices, I think.
Yeah. In the movie they used Daniel Radcliffe and Rupert Grint's voices.
Yeah.
But that was just to make it kind of fun, and it was like a family movie. Oh, it's funny.
Yeah.
It's my favorite movie.
True. Oh, my Gosh. God, you're such a loser. Hey, Mary, do you know what Terrence's favorite ending is in any movie?
In any movie or in a Harry Potter?
In a Harry Potter movie. It's at the end of Chamber of Secrets.
No, right? Chamber of Secrets.
Yeah, when Hagrid comes back and they start clapping for him. That's Terrence's favorite. He cries.
It's fun.
What is so wrong with that?
It's stupid and corny. That's what's wrong with it.
No, it isn't.
Oh, Hagrid, you're back. Yay. We love you.
It is his favorite.
It's my favorite now. Okay. Mary, you've been to the Wizarding World, right? Becca, you've been there. Grayson, you haven't. The reunion of friends. The reunion of friends thing.
Oh, ho, ho.
Okay.
That's nice.
Okay. They have the theme music playing in the park, like, all the time. Thanks, Grayson. And this music gets me every freaking time. Let me go ahead and that music right there. It's like I want to stand up and clap, you know? I want to...
Okay.
Come on. It is the best ending ever to a Harry Potter movie.
Nope.
Did you cry at the end of Sleepless in Seattle, too?
No, I didn't.
You sure about that one?
I'm positive.
You've seen Sleepless in Seattle. I have.
But no, best
thing. Suck your thumb when watching Pearl Harbor? Did you cry when Ben Affleck didn't get the girl?
No, because he ultimately got the girl in the end.
He didn't?
Yeah, he did.
When's the last time you've seen Pearl Harbor?
Like 3 weeks ago?
He didn't get the girl in the end? Are you stupid?
He did get the girl at the end.
His best friend dies, and then he comes back and brings his body back. That's all that happens.
And he ends up with the girl.
Harry Potter.
Sorry.
Harry Potter.
I hate Pearl Harbor. God damn
anyway.
It. What do you do?
Anyway, let's talk about the chapter. Come on, Grayson. Mary, you had some really good, really great, interesting points about this chapter of what we could expect to see. You want to go ahead and discuss those?
Yeah, so this is a chapter where we find out that Snape is the headmaster at Hogwarts now. And as soon as that happens, Hermione jumps up and goes and grabs Phineas Nigelus. Am I saying his name right? Phineas Nigelus's portrait and puts it in her bag. And I checked on IMDb. He hasn't been cast, so obviously they're going to cut that out. Not a big deal. But then later on in the book, Snape, the reason that Snape is able to give them the
it's because of his portrait,
because
yeah.
Of Phineas, because Phineas has told him where they are. So I wonder how Snape is going to know, or maybe they just won't even say how Snape knows, because yeah. I could see them doing that.
They probably wouldn't explain it. They're probably just going to have, like, in the Pensive, they're going to show that he, you know, puts the sword there or sets, you know, does whatever to it. So they don't have to explain it really.
Yeah.
I mean, they do just for common sense, but I mean, if they don't want to, they don't have to do it, they don't have to do it, you know. They could get away with that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
You also brought up some other really good points.
She made me look bad. Bringing up points. And
no, she did. She did. She prepared. Actually came prepared. That's right.
Like, you feel like a loser now? Like
pretty much.
Well, one of the questions that you did pose was, will Harry, Ron, and Hermione use a more cinematic way to subdue the ministry people? What exactly do you mean, a more cinematic way?
Well, because in the book, they stun one of them, and then they give a nosebleed nougat to another one, and what's the vomiting one?
Puking pastis?
Puking pastel.
The puking pastel, yes. So, wow, brain fart. Yeah. So... I wonder if they're going to use a more, you know, a more flashy way to kind of, because those are all kind of boring.
Here's what I envision.
I mean, the stunning is boring for moviegoers anyway.
Here's what I envision. Three wizards walk through the, walk past the alley Harry, Ron, and Hermione are in. Harry walks out, pulls out a 9mm, says, give me all your money. And then they refuse at first, but then Harry, or Ron and Hermione flank them also with 9mm. And they force them to give up their clothes and give up their hair. And then they knock them out with the butts of their gun.
Gracie, I thought you were actually... Yeah, I thought you were actually going somewhere with that. That they're going to be in an alley. Okay, and three wizards are going to walk by, and then they're going to kind of do that stupid little whole jump scene.
Smack them with the butt of the gun on the face.
Well, no, they're going to do like a whole stupid like jump scene, and you'll hear it like Hermione go, stupefy, or something like that.
No, they won't.
And then you'll see them walk out.
No, they won't do that. That's stupid. That's like what cartoons do.
No, that's more of a cinematic way to do it.
Really? They make it funny, but any ideas? Like stunning them, then they fall down and smack themselves, and it's like all awkward. And that'd be cool.
Becca, you have any ideas?
I'm not really sure.
Go with my idea, Becca.
No.
It's a really good one.
No, it's not. Just no.
Fine.
I don't know. Like I've been thinking about it, but I can't really come up with anything that would be anything different than the books. Like any way that they could really work it out very well.
Right.
I don't know.
I'm saying they could just.
I'm sure there's other ways that they can manage it, or you know, they might not even completely show it or whatever. But
yeah, that'd be dumb though. That's like what Terrence is saying. Like they just like. It's all of a sudden dark, and it's like, oh, and it's like cat noises. It's like, and then all of a sudden they walk out. It's like what cartoons do. I don't want to do that.
What were the sound effects of that?
Like, it's like a, it's like, ah, it's a big squabble like this.
All right. So I just have this image of Daniel Radcliffe entering the Ministry of Magic in the toilet, like from the toilet. Like, can you imagine him just like standing there in the toilet? That would be really funny. That would be really funny. I hope they do that, but I don't know.
Like I keep saying, they need to have moments of humor in the movie, because it's a dark movie. So then every moment they can get for humor that's in the book, they should take advantage of. So I think that would be another good one to do.
I think that they will. I agree. I mean, I think that that it would be a comedic way for him to enter, and then him kind of looking down at his feet and stepping out of the toilet like with that the kind of disgusting look on his face.
I don't know. There's a floater in there. It's just an empty toilet.
Oh, that's disgusting.
It's like someone just like desecrated it. It's just a toilet, empty thing. Whatever.
Anyway.
It's got to be uncomfortable standing in a toilet.
It does. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Except he did say that he didn't get wet though. Like his feet and stuff weren't wet. So it probably is. Well, it's probably a little uncomfortable. It was a giant hole in the middle of it, but you know.
Yeah.
How do you? Yeah.
I should try that. See how that works.
Can you? I can imagine.
Well, I'll let you do that and then get back to me.
Okay.
Grayson,
well, that's what Daniel Radcliffe should do. That's what method actors do. They experience things and then they use that to form their character. That's what Heath Ledger did for the Joker. So all he has to do is stand in the toilet. He's got the role.
Grayson, why don't you film that and put it on YouTube and see if you
if people donate or do our Audible thing.
Oh yeah, that's true. That's
if
true.
We get money for touring or not for touring, sorry, that's we're not doing that. What?
way to let the cat out of the bag. Yes, signing. We are touring next year, ladies and gentlemen. Awesome. All right.
Yeah,
next.
Sorry I announced that on accident. We will if we get money. First announcing it, people will give us money. Anything.
Yes. Anyway. I think that would be pretty cool. It just sounds disgusting standing in a toilet. I don't know. I don't know about you. I mean, okay. Anyway.
I don't know.
Anyway. There was. Let's see. There was another point here. Did the trio stay on set and advise the Polyjuice actors? That is a good one. Good job, Mary.
Yeah, because I mean, I'm sure the actors who are playing the three ones that they Polyjuice, they probably, you know, watch all the movies, study the character and everything. But what would be better than actually having the real actors on set, Dan, Rupert, and Emma, advising you, like, okay, well, if you did this, you'd look more like, you know, the character.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I could see that. I mean, especially Ron.
You know, I think the reason that they included those the voices in Chamber of Secrets is because it's so hard to convey being somebody else if you're in another body. You know, like it's easier to do that when you have that person's voice instead of just emotions. Because if you were to watch that scene in Chamber of Secrets without Rupert and Dan's voice, you wouldn't be able to tell really without knowing that it was Harry and Ron. Like they don't do anything explicitly. Like Harry and Ron, you know what I mean? Like all that happens is that Ron's hair starts to turn red at the end. That's about it. Everything else, their emotions and everything are all the same as those two actors.
Yeah.
Yeah, but a lot of it is physical too. Like the way they act, like how we know from the trailer when Bellatrix, when Helena Bonham Carter has that really worried look on her face because she looks like Hermione whenever Hermione crinkles her eyebrows together when she's worried. Mm. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I just mean like it's really hard to do that as an actor, like to be somebody else, like do somebody else's motions when you're playing a different character, like you're trying to play two characters basically at the same time.
Yeah,
so you have to play Harry, Ron, and Hermione, but you also play whoever they are portraying.
Right, exactly. So you kind of have to play a character who's playing a character.
Yeah, exactly.
Of yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. One more thing I was wondering about this chapter was the statue in the center.
Oh
of
my god, I almost forgot
the Ministry
about
of
that.
Magic that has.
Oh, I totally forgot about that.
I didn't because I read the book.
What?
None of that.
Yeah.
I wonder if I really hope that they leave that in. I could totally see them leaving that in, and then Hermione whispering to Harry, "They're sitting on Muggles," you know? Because if they don't explain that they're sitting on Muggles, then people are just going to be like, "Okay, well." They're people sitting on people.
Yeah, that would be so cool. Just walk in, there's like a giant statue. Just a fat. That'd be awesome.
That would be that kind of concerns me. Would that be enough to draw like an R rating?
Oh, are you kidding me?
No,
I wouldn't.
I mean, because they're naked.
Well, that and the fact that, I mean, the description really isn't pleasant. I'm sorry, I don't have the description up right now, but
it's like a black statue, and then there's got some like naked bodies, like all the muggles below it.
Yeah,
a wizard and a witch on a throne. Is that right?
I don't think it would be enough to draw an R rating. I think if anything in this movie would draw an R rating, it would be the snake coming out of Bathilda's neck. But I think they'll do that just the right way so that they can still get a PG-13.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, the statue's not that bad. You don't have to show like everything naked. So there's not, you know. Have you seen some PG-13 movies lately? They were really bad.
Yeah.
Also,
but
there's a difference between like a piece of art or a statue or something versus like an actual person standing there naked. Like, you can get away with so many things like that. Like, just because there's a statue or some piece of art that's showing a little more skin than necessary, it's not going to give something an R rating.
Right, like that Michelangelo sculpture.
David?
Which one is it?
David.
Yeah, David. Yeah, that is in lots of movies, and they don't really ever cover it up, and it's not in any, like, R-rated. Risque movies.
Well, you really can't. I mean, unless you're really focusing, and it's usually a quick shot. I mean, they don't sit there and focus straight on the dude's, you know.
But you know, nudity and, like I said, nudity and art are different things. Like, it's different to do it in a gratuitous way, and then to have it as in like a sculpture in a non-human form.
Well, we see it like that, but we know how screwed up the MPAA is. We've said it before, and we've talked about it. So it all comes down to that, you know, that group of people sitting there, and the MPA panel is really their parents.
the thing about the MPAA is that they give breaks to big studios and big movies, movies that people like Kevin Smith make are going to get like NC-17 ratings because it's a low budget movie, that kind of thing. But with Harry Potter, it, unless it really pushes it, it's not going to get anything any R-rated because it would lose a lot of money. And the MPAA doesn't want that.
That's true. But is there anything else in this chapter, you guys? Anything that we should bring up? Or did we pretty much touch on it all?
That's about it. Yeah. Well, not that much in the chapter.
Okay. Yeah. Well,
except for creature making a mean French onion soup. That's about it.
And mincemeat pie that he said he was going to have for him whenever they got back.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. What's the pie called again?
Mincemeat pie.
No.
Kidney pie.
Yeah, kidney steak. Yeah.
Kidney and liver pie or something like that.
No, kidney steak.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, let's go ahead and go to break. We are going to let you listen to some more Wingardium Leviosa. And we'll be back in just a few minutes to play a couple of games, wrap up the show, and that'll be it. So stay tuned, you guys. We are rocking and rolling. WROCKN. WROCK in the USA.
Kidney pie looks so good.
Anyway, stay tuned, you guys. We'll be back in just a minute. Where's the best place to get the most up-to-date Harry Potter news and announcements? That's right, HPANA. Get on over to hpana.com and check it out. In addition to collecting news from numerous sites 24 hours a day, you can also visit sections such as the Quibbler, Great Hall, or the world-renowned forums with over 6.9 million posts and over 86,000 unique topics. Whatever your HP craving is, they have it. HPANA is proud to be the first Harry Potter fan site author J.K. Rowling ever visited. So what are you waiting for? Visit the Harry Potter Automated News Aggregator today at www.hpana.com.
Thank you.
So Grayson, you got a problem with the wrong answer game, right?
Yeah, I'm talking about this.
Just kidding.
I'll play it, but I just have a problem with it.
Okay. Well, we're going to play the wrong answer game now. And welcome back to the show, everybody. Sorry, Grayson. You know, he didn't want to play questions. We're not going to play questions this week because Grayson didn't want to play questions. So email all your hate mail to him at grayson@hogwartsradio.com.
Questions. Come on, let's be honest.
Tweet him. You know, cast him into the depths of hell or whatever.
That's really not. Oh, that seems to be appropriate punishment for that. Yeah.
Let's go ahead and get to the wrong answer game. Grayson, you're going to go first because awesome. I want to hurry up and get you out of the way.
No problem.
Yes.
No problem. Challenges.
Okay. Grayson, what is the Muggle-born registration commission?
That's like, okay, you know, Vietnam back in the day, you had to register for the draft, and same thing in World War II. Instead of getting their hands dirty, the pureblood wizards are sending all of the Muggle-borns to fight Voldemort for them. They don't want to do that. So, in the book, it says that Voldemort was behind it and they're trying to get rid of them. No, really, they're trying to get rid of them in a different way. They're just sending them off to war to fight the Vietnamese and Voldemort.
So. Wow, that is a,
for all the wrong that the Vietnamese have done.
Grayson, I don't even know what to say to that.
Pretty impressive, huh?
That's it.
All right, then.
Okay.
So fast. I don't know.
Yeah. Anyway, okay.
Awesome. I don't know what it is.
Okay. Becca, this question. Yeah. This question is for you. Becca, what is the Yule Ball?
We already did this.
No, we didn't.
Sorry.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Anyway.
What is the Yule Ball, Becca?
The Yule Ball is a... Oh, I'm so bad at these games. I hate
She says
much.
That every time.
I know.
She always just really strong, and then she's kind of like, it's like, oh, God.
I know. I keep Suck. Hoping that I'll think of something as I'm talking, but I can't think that fast.
Yeah.
All right, the Yule Ball is, you remember in gym class how you guys in elementary school or whatever, you had like these, like a bunch of different kind of balls that you would have to throw, like there's basketballs, dodgeballs, whatever.
Yes.
The Yule Ball is a special thing that they introduce in the gym classes we never see at Hogwarts. And I don't know what kind of game they play with it, but it's something like that. Give me a break, it's almost 12:30 in the morning, I'm so tired.
Wow, that was a good one.
I actually got through one for once. It's a miracle.
Awesome. Okay. Mary, this is for you.
Oh, my God.
Uh-oh.
This is your first
one. Your first one.
I'm nervous.
Okay. What?
It's very important. You should be nervous.
Mary, what is Potter Watch?
Oh, Potter Watch is the watch that Harry Potter has.
Hey. Nice.
That was awesome. Yes. Easy one. Okay.
That was right there. It was too easy. I had to take it.
I know. I was thinking of that too. So,
yeah. Terrence.
Huh.
Terrence,
what?
What is Shell College? Shell College. What is? Start again. Terrence Mason. What is Shell Cottage?
Shell Cottage. Shell Cottage is where Ariel from The Little Mermaid lives under the sea.
But how can a cottage be underwater though?
Because how can a talking mermaid live? How can a talking mermaid live with a fish and a crab as a pet?
Because it's a movie.
Duh.
Shell Cottage isn't in the movie.
There you go. That's your answer. Shell Cottage is the place where Ariel lives.
But Shell Cottage is in the movies, so you have to somehow figure out how. Never mind.
So Shell Cottage in the movies is where Ariel goes to go bra shopping. There we go.
What? Why do you go shopping in a cottage?
There we go.
Okay.
That's my wrong answer. Thank you. Thank you, Grayson, for surprising me right on the spot. You're getting better at that.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay.
Working on it.
Yes. Thank you. I think that's about it. it's time to remind you all of our contact information for the latest Hogwarts Radio news and announcements, episodes, and things like that. We want to invite you to go to our website at hogwartsradio.com. You can always Skype the username Hogwarts Radio, like us on Facebook so the rest of your friends can get in on the fun. I'm serious, you guys. Like us on Facebook. It's not hard. You click a button. Same thing with Twitter.
And then like my page, because it only has like 6 people.
Follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/Hogwarts Radio to get the new announcements concerning the show. There is also no forums at this current time. We are working on those. We also have hpana.com for the most up-to-date Harry Potter news. And, of course, you can always email us through the contact form or our first names at hogwartsradio.com. Even Mary. You can get her at mary@hogwartsradio.com. So,
yeah, she's all official now. That's exciting.
That is. Yeah. So, I
would love to have a good chat.
Huh?
I said I would love to have a good chat about Harry Potter. If anybody wants to email me, I am down all the time.
Yeah. Definitely.
Terrence, yeah.
Sorry.
I hate when he does that. Like, I'll say something really funny, he's just like, yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. Now, that does it for this week's show, you guys. Thank you so much for listening and for being here these past 2 years with us. It really goes beyond words of how awesome all of our listeners are. So, thank you again. I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm a Vietnamese soldier who has been gunned down by the Muggleborn army.
I'm really sleepy. I'm going to bed now.
I'm just Mary.
Just Mary. Well, just Mary. Have you ever done anything you haven't expected? Wait, what?
How oh my God! Say? Shut up. We're going to bed now. We're going away. Good night. Thanks for listening, guys. We'll see you next week. Bye.
Look at Becca being all headstrong and taking the initiative.
Wow. Okay. Well,
taking the reins. Right from
you heard the boss. You heard the boss. No, anyway, thanks for listening, you guys. Episode number 56 coming to you next week. We'll talk to you guys later.
Bye.
Peace.
Bye. That was so much fun.